Tonight is also the Pianopalooza, which is a very, very special event. So quite a wonderful day. I often have the pleasure of coming out here with Ben Rowe, but I will tell you we are right at the midpoint between our two junior sessions, two junior division segments. And that means that there are lots and lots of little people moving all over the place. And we decided that I should just give the introduction myself. So, you know, chamber music is something very, it's funny for me. I grew up, I was around a lot of music. I do remember the time I was about 7 years old, and it was the first moment, actually the piece was the Brahms B major piano trio. And my father's a pianist, and he was practicing that piece for a performance. And I do remember just having this inkling as, actually I think I was more like 6 years old, and I was like, wow, there's something about this that is simply too beautiful and too powerful and too wonderful. And frankly, that sensation that started right then has not changed one bit for me until the present day, though I'd say I know a lot more about it than I did then. And of course, that process of getting to know about chamber music is an intricate and amazing process. And this has been, the seminar has been in existence for quite a few years here at the Institute. And I think Mr. Ashkenazi is, where are you in the audience there? I can't, there we are. Well, Shmuel Ashkenazi has of course led this seminar for many, many years in the most wonderful way. I think many of you may have heard Mr. Ashkenazi play the Busoni Sonata the other night. And it was just absolutely gorgeous as what the violin can do and what music can do, treated beautifully by that instrument. And that's a kind of a knowledge that applies to playing the violin, but he also brings that to the world of string quartet and to the world of music in general. And these students that you're about to hear today have had this wonderful 3 weeks where they have been just working with great intensity and great depth and really hard working at the details of what you're about to hear in all four of these pieces. Mr. Ashkenazi and I have had a wonderful time kind of looking at this. There's going to be another stage to this in the next 3 weeks, which is going to much more involve things that I'll do with them and things that the Borromeo String Quartet will do with them. What I'm so happy about is that all 16 students that you're going to hear today are getting the chance to take on the most valuable kind of challenge and are able to take it on with really a kind of depth of advice and depth of participation in their working process that I think is just a great, great privilege for them and something that I know Mr. Ashkenazi said this many times, I feel it too. Regardless of what one achieves right at this moment, what's being given is a foundation for how to approach this music for years and years to come. And I think this is just a absolutely beautiful and treasured, I absolutely treasure this part of the Institute that we are doing exactly this undertaking. So maybe it's just a moment, I'd love to say thank you to Mr. Ashkenazi for what he's done. So. And what I mentioned about the Brahms, there is just a hope. All these pieces are so different. The students are gonna describe some things about each of the pieces that they're playing. It just amazes me that you have a piece like the Haydn that, you know, hundreds of years after its invention or its creation, it continues to allow us to discover things about ourselves and celebrate things that we share, all of us as people and all of us as imaginative feeling beings. I just hope that this tradition continues forever, and I appreciate all that all of us are doing to make that happen. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us today. We're very pleased to be presenting a quartet in C major, Opus 74, number 1 by Joseph Haydn. Now, I didn't know this until recently because Haydn's music is so distinguished, refined, delicate, and graceful. I always assumed that Haydn was a pretty boring guy, but but I realized recently that he's actually a pretty goofy person. When he was very young, he was old enough to know better, but he was in the Vienna's boys choir, which is still alive and well today. And he was sitting behind this guy, and I guess he thought his hair was too long because he pulled out of a pair of scissors and just chopped off his ponytail. This had to have been a premeditated crime because, you know, who carries around scissors all the time? You know? But anyway, so this music really opened up for me after hearing stories like, oh, by the way, he got kicked out of school completely after that, so. His dreams of being a barber were alive. Anyway, but once I heard these stories about Haydn, I began to see his music very differently. Instead of being, with a stick up your butt, you know, and really, I began to hear his music with much more joy and a delightful, wicked mischief that he himself held. I really hope you enjoy this piece as much as we enjoy playing it. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. We are the Cassiopeia String Quartet, and today we'll be playing the quartet entitled Intimate Letters, which is Leos Janáček's second string quartet. A few words about this piece. It's entitled Intimate Letters at the direction of his 11-year obsession with a woman, 37 years his junior, named Kamila Stoslova. Yikes. And he was married at the time, and so was Kamila. And this was a exceptionally unrequited interest that Janáček had. And over the course of his last 11 years of life, he wrote over 700 letters, most of them love letters to Kamila, most of which were not responded to. And this subject served as the basis for the second string quartet, so it's kind of an exploration into the psyche of Janáček and this pretty intense obsession he had. So there are four movements. The first movement is very indignant, angry, and kind of an expository kind of movement. The second movement is ostensibly the slow movement, and in us working on this piece, I've been convinced that he was heavily influenced by Debussy's orchestral piece, La Mer. In terms of the harmonies, there's a lot of dignity and intensity that I think is especially reminiscent of the first movement of La Mer. So that's just an interesting side note. And then the third movement, perhaps most disturbingly, is thought to have been Janáček's lullaby for the child he wanted to have with Kamila, which he never did. So this is all quite unflattering stuff. And to make matters worse, there's a recurring motif in the third movement that sounds like this. And what that is Janáček's heartbeat flipping onto 100% mode, thinking about Kamila. Also quite unpleasant, but you'll see that permeated throughout the movement. And then finally, we have the fourth movement, which is kind of a quixotic, celebratory movement that, while has elements of heroism, is, of course, he recognizes to some extent the delusion in which he's found himself in. So it's kind of this raucousy finale that just gets more and more intense as it goes on. And there's a particular moment about three quarters of the way through this movement that I think is Janáček accepting on a deep level, maybe without him realizing it in the front of his brain, but maybe more near the back of his brain, that this is a doomed obsession he has. And it's just some of the most lamentful and hurtful music you'll ever hear, in my opinion. And after he kind of has this realization, it's just this race to the end and a crazy amount of fury that is quite unparalleled. And the last thing I'd like to add is that Janáček's favorite chord was a D flat major chord, which sounds like this. I don't know why it was D flat major, but he loved that chord. But he loved that chord plus an extra note, which doesn't fit into the chord, which is an E flat, which sounds like this. And there's kind of this unsatisfaction and unease that that chord puts us in. And that's the chord he ends this piece on. So with all that being said, let's listen to Intimate Letters. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, we're pretty lucky.
Hi, Charlie. Kathy.
Hi, Charlie.
This is my daughter, Erin.
Hi.
Good afternoon. We are the Vela Quartet, and today we'll be playing the String Quartet in G minor by Debussy. This piece is such an instrumental piece in the chamber music repertoire. It's such a fixture of everything that we play, and it's one that is so important. Although at the time it was received some very mixed reviews. You know, Debussy tried to use a lot of the soundscapes and how he composed a lot of the movements. And because of that, it has a very unique texture, something that wasn't very typical at the time, but nowadays we regard it with such revere and such, you know, making it this staple that, you know, as a chamber musicians, we must all be familiar with. Starting with the first movement, it's a very animated, very driven movement. It's one that right from the get-go, it's incredibly outgoing, it's very driven, and it has a certain pulse that very rarely starts to deviate. The second movement is my personal favorite. It's one that actually uses soundscapes in a really unique way. For example, at the beginning, three of us will be playing pizzicato, while the viola will, you know, in a rare moment of being able to hog the limelight, will be able to have some sort of ostinato-like melody, and is one that is a very unique melody. When you hear it, it's very cool, and it's one that first violinist will play, then cello, and we all get the ability to play it at certain times throughout the movements. It's a very fun piece. I absolutely love it. The third movement is our slow movement. It's one that's incredibly beautiful, and again, Debussy uses soundscapes in a really unique way. It's, for example, we all start the movement off muted. So it has this, retains this very haunting, ethereal nature, and then towards the middle of the movement, the mutes will actually come off, and we actually get to have our natural resonance for our instruments, and they start to sing a little more. And then you can kind of tell when the end starts to come, because the mutes will get another surprise reappearance, and we start to hear that very haunting, almost celestial nature that I always think of it of, and it kind of drifts off, and it's a very beautiful movement. It's one that we all get these, we kind of pair off sometimes into melodies, and it's a really fun movement. The last one, our finale, is one that's very reminiscent of the first movement. It's very driven, although it doesn't start off that way. It starts a little more passive and very much deep in thought. It's one that eventually ramps up, and the pulse starts to quicken, and it has this very much emotionally charged piece of music that's very reminiscent of the first one. This is an incredible string quartet in our entire literature, and it's one that I never had the opportunity to learn until I came here, and I've had an absolute blast. I know we all have, and I'm just looking forward to having some fun today with these incredibly talented human beings here beside me, and of course with all of you. So I hope you enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. afternoon, everyone. My name is Claire, and today I am joined by Miranda on first violin, Minche on second violin, and Will on the viola, and together we are the Libra Quartet. Today we're going to be playing for you Beethoven's Opus 59, number 2, string quartet. And I have to preface this by saying I know it's been a long concert, so I was going to keep my speech short and sweet, but then our communications director, Daniel Petro, told me to speak slower, and I got excited by what I was going to talk about, so it might be a little longer. So to me, this quartet is about Beethoven's exploration of heaven and earth, of the universe. The quartet opens with the Big Bang, the first and fifth chords of E minor, the Keys piece, the strongest chords that he could have picked. And Miranda's going to, or the whole quartet's going to demonstrate that for you. The Big Bang. You're going to hear these chords throughout the first movement several times, interspersed between awe-filled, yet also searching motives. The second movement is a trip to heaven. It's my favorite movement and really, really beautiful. Miranda's going to play very long melodic lines, but at the same time, Beethoven juxtaposes these ethereal melodies with the ticking of a clock, which is represented, and you can hear it in a dotted rhythm, which Miranda will demonstrate for you. Thank you, Miranda. The third movement is a Russian folk tune. Beethoven chose a Russian folk tune because he wanted to honor Count Razumovsky, which for whom he dedicated these Opus 59 middle quartets to. So that's going to repeat many times, and we're going to pass the melody through the four of us. The last movement is a very happy C major dance, but at the very last minute, Beethoven grounds us and pulls us back to earth with an E minor explosion, just like the beginning of the piece. I think this piece is Beethoven's way of exploring heaven and earth with his picture into heaven, but also his grounding in time and earthly things. And I think it represents, for a lot of us, our struggle to know both earthly and heavenly desires and how that fits into our lives. So this is my favorite quartet that I've played so far, and we're going to end the concert with a bang. Thank you.
The Heifetz International Music Institute and its Festival of Concerts. More than 50 live concerts in Stanton, Virginia, and daily programs streaming worldwide. Full calendar and information at heifetzinstitute.org.